Oh man, so many people here. I'm a bit excited, a bit nervous. Yesterday during the speaker's dinner or late lunch, after 3.5 hours walking through the city, they gave us something like fire water, and I felt so relaxed after that. They told me it's like 50% alcohol, so... And I just learned that this is the one, this brand. Everybody tried that? Well, maybe I should actually try this myself now. That will help. I'm honored to be here. I'm also impressed, like all these people showing up on Saturday. Usually I don't even wake up at this time, but yeah. Decomposing the monolith using modernday.net and a touch of microservices. It's a bit of a catchy title, so. I think the topic today is kind of microservices related. I saw it several times being mentioned, or everything about building distributed systems. I'm actually going to tell you today how not to go into the distributed world just yet. Well. So let's start with the pains of monoliths. Who has actually built a monolith? Who's actually happy with it? Oh, really? I had two people actually happy. I think that's a good thing. I'll explain why. So there's lots of problems with monoliths. Yeah, I mean, you have multiple patterns for the same solution. Like three different ways for accessing your database. You have a hybrid of technologies. I mean, JavaScript world doesn't really change that fast, does it? Backbone. Whatever else, React, Vue.js, Angular, version 8, I think now. So 8 breaking changes in like 5 years. What the hell? A long compile time, maybe. You know, your code base becomes bigger, it takes more time. For some reason, I actually noticed that all the JavaScript stuff gets longer. Webpack takes a long time, you know, bundling and transpiling and all this stuff that we do these days. .NET is super fast. Long sort of big source control repositories, yeah, sure. Long running unit tests. Anybody using unit tests? What? That's only a quarter of the people. Just to verify, because this is a .NET conference, right? So yeah, just to make sure. Who is actually still programming? Just to verify that. Only half of the people. So the rest is either an architect or a manager. Yeah. So what am I doing here, actually? Oh, I'll just continue. I'll talk a lot about architecture, so that's usually good. Too much coupling, you know? You touch here something in your code base, and there stuff starts to fail. Well, I mean, 3/4 of you do not use unit tests, so you don't even know it fails until you put it in production. Limited team scalability. Oh, somebody. I have to stay here. Oh, okay. Sorry. I'll stay in the middle. I can't see my screen now. So, I mean, your monolith. Okay. Operational issues, yeah, I mean, it's like a real software project. Limited team scalability, you know, you start with 5 people, then 10, then 15, then 20, then 30, 50, 70, and then like everybody just commits to source control and everything starts to fall apart, and you try to find ways around that, yeah. Devs that need to know everything, front-end, back-end, database, you know, HTML, CSS stuff, all this stuff you need to know. Productivity eventually starts to drop because of that. You know, you get slower and slower, and your product owner says, like, you know, why does it take so much time to build this small feature? Yeah, but we have technical debt, and you're not solving our technical debt, and you don't give us enough time. Yeah, okay, cool. It's all because there's no isolation. But is it only really bad because two people actually kept their hands raised because they're happy with the monolith? And somebody, I don't remember exactly, says, like, having a monolith in production for a while actually is proof of success. You've been really successful. You put something in production, and you managed to keep it in production. So it means you have actually earned money from that. That's a good thing, I would say, right? So don't look so sad. It's a good thing. Okay, who am I? Dennis Doelman from the Netherlands. You can probably hear that from the accent. I'm on an everlasting quest to find new things to do my job better on architecture, tools, people, because, yeah, a big part of the job these days is people. I don't know, infrastructure, the processes, on every aspect of my job, I'm trying to find better ways to do it. I love to learn, I love to engage with people, so if you find me later on after the talk and have complaints or feedback, stay away. I'll go to the speaker launch and stay there all day long now. I'll probably be drinking this, what do? I have a blog, I have a couple of open source projects, C# coding guidelines for the last 20 years, some kind of library maybe talk about, maybe you know this, yeah. 25 people do unit testing. Anybody using this library? Oh, see, I have fans. And another library that I create. I just spin up libraries and, you know, I love sharing my experiences. So, let's say you have this monolith. Why don't you just decompose it and modularize it? I mean, thousands of books have been written about that, right? You don't have to do all this fancy-pancy stuff. You just break it down. Maybe something like this. Functional decomposition. You know, multiple vertical slices that kind of isolate it. You can do that. I mean, it's perfectly possible, even in the same code base. You can draw nice PowerPoint pictures, put it on the wall, and, you know, structure your code in functional folders. And there's a couple of things you can do. You can, for instance, say, like, the composition level is kind of connecting everything together, so more isolation. You can say, like, each module kind of exposes its own data and also owns its own master data. So you're basically breaking down in nice pieces. You should actually apply dry. Anybody applying dry? Yeah? The rest is just connecting everything with everything, just coupling the whole shebang, yeah? Spaghetti. Dry is a good thing. Don't repeat yourself, just in case you didn't know. It's a really good thing, but you need to understand that you need to apply it in boundaries. Doing it everything creates a huge amount of coupling. And then people will tell you, dry is a bad thing, and there will be a presentation at the conference. You should not do dry, or dry is the road to hell. This is what happens. It should not depend on anything except maybe some created shared services that you really think you do not want to duplicate. Every module defines its own contracts, and there's a couple of things, I will not mention everything here, but the point being is that you really decompose it into blocks. It's the same code base, and you just define structures. You provide, it's perfectly possible to do that. Many companies have been very successful in that. It just means you need to have discipline. And what do developers typically have? No discipline. Especially if you use tools like ReSharper or JetBrains Rider. You know, if you use something from a completely different module that says, like, hey, it's not available, Alt-Enter, using namespace, and suddenly you have a connection again. It's really easy. Even if you put it in separate projects, it's so easy to break those walls. But it's a very valid thing. And if you use proper pull request review for that, it's a feasible approach. Well, I'll skip the rest. By the way, dependency inversion principle. Solid. Who's doing Solid here? Practicing Solid? Again, like 10%. Yeah, the rest of you are architects and managers, eh? That's true. I forgot about that. Yeah, I need to remember that. Sorry. Okay. But if that's not enough, what do? We find the next silver bullet, which is called microservices. So, show you this. You know what this is? The hype cycle. Yes, the hype cycle. It's really cool. I'm not sure if I can actually move here, but it all starts with a technology trigger, which is something like, you know, a speaker on stage telling you that something is really cool. And what do? You become enthusiastic. If it's a good speaker, you become enthusiastic. You start to use it. And then you become even more enthusiastic, and you start to use it everywhere. Microservices are great. You know, the whole world is doing it, so it's awesome. Must be really great. You know, and then you end up at some point at the peak of inflated expectations. You're going to start blog posts about it, how great they are. You may even decide to do your own talk at a conference. You know, the greatness of microservices. And then you start putting stuff in production, and you learn actually that, you know, there's also a dark side to everything. You know, some things don't always work like that. You know, and then at some point you start to dive down in the throe of disillusionment. Like, ah, man, this silver bullet doesn't exist anyway. It was not that great. You know, and then you start to talk about, like, don't do microservices, don't do dry, don't do test-driven development, because it's so bad, and it leads you to, don't do solid. I've actually seen a presentation that says, solid is a bad thing. Like, guys, come on. And then you finally enter the slope of enlightenment. You know, you get enlightenment, you actually understand that things are not always as black and white as people seem to make it clear. You understand that test-driven development works in a certain context. Dry is a good thing, but you need to understand boundaries, you know? You become professional. And I see everybody like, yes, I'm a professional, yes, yes. And then you become productive. It's the same with everything, even with microservices. Okay, why? Well, what's actually microservice? Maybe it's good to also mention that. I looked it up. I went to Martin Fowler's blog post, of Blicky it's called, is where he defines all the patterns. And he basically confirmed there's not really an precise definition. What is a microservice? Yeah, it's small. Yeah, it encapsulates a domain. No, it doesn't. No. Like, you can have endless debates with people. Especially on Saturday morning. No. Especially during a speaker's dinner where everybody finished a couple of these. You can have great debates. So there's no real exact definition. But what Martin Fowler kind of confirms is that, yeah, there are kind of services that run out of process. Okay, cool. Makes sense. And they communicate over well-known protocols. Like, I don't know, JSON, REST. Again, REST, what is that? That's sort of thing. And remote procedure calls, maybe, but some kind of communication mechanism. .NET remoting, maybe? Is anybody that old that remembers .NET remoting? I can't really see the color of the hairs, but usually it's... I remember it. I even remember C++, yes. Okay, great time. Oh, man. Time without mobile phones. You know, I see people look at me, what? Without mobile phones? What, did that exist? Yes. Watch Stranger Things, you know what it is like. So let's look at a bit of a pros and cons. I took this picture from the internet to kind of emphasize like what a world with microservices looks like. Lots of services here. They're very scalable, very reliable. You can just scale them out, you know, run 10 different instances of the same service at the same time. You can deploy them independently, you can upgrade them independently, which is really cool because isolation. Very difficult to debug sometimes, yeah. Have you ever debugged a multi-threaded problem? Multi-process problem? Well, again, 25% developers, the rest is an architect. Yes, I forget that. But yeah, it's really difficult. I've done it myself. Multi-process debugging, trying to trace down something that goes from one process. Anybody using async await? You know, you feel the pain, right? Yeah. But network is unreliable, so you need to deal with that. You need to think about timeouts. You need to think about circuit breakers with exponential backoff. And of course, we have great libraries in the .NET space. Poly is one example that helps you with that. But it's just a tool. You still need to deal with that. That was one of the flaws of .NET remoting and COM, distributed COM. It kind of assumed that the network doesn't exist. Well. At some point, you need some kind of message broker or API gateways. And I remember in 2014 when I was talking, going to QCon in New York, they were also talking about microservices and the versioning problem and the networking issues. And two years later, there were like hundreds of different products that would solve all these problems for you. Of course, they didn't, but yeah. lots of stuff. End-to-end testing is very practical. But since 10% of people only do unit testing, they don't even know what it is. Yeah. But yeah, other things, a DevOps culture. Yeah, why would you need that? I mean, deploying thousands of little monoliths is really easy, right? No? Okay. So I think you really need some kind of mature organization to be before you're ready for that. Monitoring, visualization, you know, what's going on. Alex Tisse will also talk about this later on a little bit, about health checking and telemetry, which is very useful in this world. High operational maintenance, yeah. I mean, if you're not even capable of efficiently deploying your monolith, then don't try the rest. Well, and an explosion of network activity. So, distributed computing, there's a couple of laws. And the first law of distributed computing is don't do it. Okay. So, let's look at an alternative. I'm breaking down my monolith into functional modules, just as I showed you. There's one difference, and it's really clear from the picture. Loose coupling through HTTP. Like, hey, wait, you put your modules, you break it down to modules, and then you use HTTP to connect them? Yes, that's what I do. Yeah, yeah. These modules run in process, which means easy debugging. Everything runs in the same process. No distributed things. No network I/O. That's also. You can even release it as a NuGet package. You can build modules, extract them from your monolith code base, define an HTTP API, but then use them in process, which is loose coupling. You can even say, I'm going to assign different teams to those modules, which is the scalability thing we talked about. It may be the same people that were originally on the monolith, but you can at least say, you know, we have a couple of people that own this component. You know, they approve all the pull requests. But you still ship it as one thing. You make sure that the dependencies are minimized, which is what we want anyway, because we don't want to end up in dependency hell, which we all are. Anybody using NPM? Even less. I really wonder if this is the right conference for me, but yeah. Every module owns its schema, owns its database storage, and it can be something that you reuse between the different components. It's perfectly fine. But at least it's each component really acts like it's an independent thing as much as possible. That's the crucial aspect of it. But you're still deploying it as a monolith. I made it red, as if it's a bad thing, it's more like it's a disadvantage of this solution. And it's an alternative. Doesn't mean you have to do it like that, I'm just sharing some of the ideas that I've been practicing. Of course, since it's deployed as a monolith, you have less scalability options. You know, that's something to consider. And HTTP is not the fastest thing. But I'm saying we're not actually touching the network stack. How does that work? Well, we use something called OWIN, which is an interesting concept, and I'll explain what it looks like these days because it changed a bit. Where there's something like you can do this in .NET. There's a client, and the client sends an HTTP request. The client can be a browser. It can also be another part of your system. It can be even a class inside your code base. And the request can go to IIS, if it's a real product. It can go to a console application. It can even go to a Windows service. Or even a unit test. You can send an HTTP request inside your unit test. What will happen is you have something called what they call middleware. And it receives a set of data, which we call an environment, which is just a bunch of information, request body, headers, some context about the environment, maybe security attributes, which are sent there, and then the middleware returns a handler, very conceptually. And then the return HTTP response. That means that the right side of this picture does not even know about HTTP. It just receives information that it can process. This is a dictionary, actually. It's just a dictionary of strings and objects. It's very loosely coupled. This is what we had in .NET Framework, by the way. And what we return is a task. So it's something asynchronous. However, a middleware is part of a chain of middlewares. So there can be another piece of middleware. Oh, by the way, that's the definition. A func of an iDictionary of string of object which returns a task. Don't we love funcs and lambdas and stuff? Functional programming is the next big hype. But the middleware can talk to another middleware, so we have another one. It's called next. And since that thing is also a func of a dictionary or a string of object returning a task, if you combine that, you have this. A func of a dictionary returning a task, which returns a func of a dictionary that returns a task. I need some water. There's people that love this stuff. They get like, oh, funcs are funcs. I can use Lambda. But OK, now we're in the ASP.NET Core world because everybody is moving to .NET Core. That's the future. All these enterprise systems that we build will just, you know, flip over to .NET Core painlessly. But now we have something else. Now we have, actually, we have the same thing. It's still there. The only difference is that because it's Microsoft, they try to make everything explicit and type safe. So we have something called context now. And it returns still a handler. And it still returns, causes the HTTP response to return. Still the same concept. Now it's called an HTTP context, which is a different beast than we used to have in ASP.NET web forms or something, and still returns a task. And you can still have a next. And the next one is also an HTTP function that returns HTTP context. Sorry, gets a context, returns a task. You don't have to remember all this stuff. It's already on the internet. And everything on the internet is true. So this is kind of, it's a better definition, actually. A lot of people think it's simpler. But the point being is, you can actually do this in process without touching the network because it's all abstractions. You basically have type-safe classes that encapsulate network or HTTP requests. So you can use it in process. By the way, you don't have to do this, what I'm saying. You can also use like interfaces and stuff like that, but it's more tightly coupled. So how does this work? Every module has an entry point, which is an HTTP API. Controllers, if you want. Nancy, if you love open source development. Still possible. You know, you document your contract using OpenAPI, Swagger, if you don't know what it is. Each request, you know, includes some kind of ID that flows through the entire system. That's really useful because you still want to start getting used to the concept of multiple modules and information flows through these modules. You still want to be able to trace that a bit, understand how things happen. Yes, you can still attach a debugger and put some breakpoints here and there, but it's good to start using to get used to that. It's actually a path. And then you use webhooks, you know, that you use for GitHub and stuff like that, to signal back to the rest of the system. Again, OpenIP of OpenAPI. Again, IDs to help trace. And then every module can talk to that module through API, HTTP. It's also Saturday morning for me. But they need to be liberal on that. Again, it's HTTP, you need to be loosely coupled. You need to actually understand that if you get a request and there's extra information in the JSON body, if you choose JSON, which is default these days, that you ignore that. That helps decouple it a little bit. That's the advantage. If you don't want to do that, then use explicit types. Don't forget about the whole HTTP thing. Just use .NET classes and interfaces. But you can do that. That's value to that. The module registry is just a stupid class that tracks, keeps track of all the modules in your process. So that if the first module or the second module in this picture wants to connect to the first one, it requests an HTTP client without knowing where the other module is. It's like kind of dependency injection thing. Or like, I want to have an implementation of this interface. I don't care where it is in my code base. I just want to talk to that. It's the same concept here. But it abstracts where it is, and that's important for the future. And then the subscribers actually do the same thing. They don't add an URL on the webhook to say, I want to be called like that. No, they give it an HTTP client that talks to the other services. So everything feels like this is all running out of process, but it's not. That's the advantage. They can even ask, like, give me everything that happened in the past. Because, I don't know, my schema changed. I need to rebuild some cache or something like that. Everything that you would do if you build a distributed system, except all the complexities of network overhead, you still keep everything in memory. You start to get used to that. It doesn't mean that every module should use the same architecture style. This is really important. There's a lot of different architecture styles, but an architecture style, every component, every module, if you're anybody doing DDD, domain-driven design, a couple of people, you may know the term bounded context. It's really closely related to that. Every module can potentially be a bounded context. Every domain has specific requirements about scalability, which is not an issue here because you don't scale. It's a monolith. It's fine. But you may have different requirements in terms of querying, consistency, performance maybe. You know, all this stuff that defines what kind of architecture you want to have for that. There's not a single choice for the whole system. You never do that. Let me show you an example. I have a couple of modules. I have a drafting module. This is a legal system that, you know, tracks legal documents. So you have a module that is more about drafting a legal document, collecting information, attaching document PDFs to it, defining all these mumble-dumble legal terminology. Then you have a module that's more about policy execution. This is where the lawyers are going to be reviewing this document, putting their signatures on it. There's a complicated process with that. The first module is mostly about one guy or girl or whoever writing something. The second module is collaboration. But since this is a big firm, they have lots of legal documents, they also need a search module. Would you use the same architecture style in every module? Of course not. There's no single tool that will solve all your problems. So in this case, I would say drafting modules, maybe a really stupid CRUD architecture, you know, with a web API and maybe a nice front end, or maybe a simple domain, an ORM, or maybe even a NoSQL solution, just put it in MongoDB or RavenDB. It's perfectly normal. You don't need to track anything. You don't need to, there's no complicated stuff there. You may even write it as JSON into a single table storage in Azure. Perfectly fine. But the policy execution module is much more complicated. You know, we need to track exactly who did what. So maybe you use something like event sourcing as an architecture style. Has anybody heard of event sourcing? Ooh, almost as many people as do unit testing. Okay. Architects. But that's also a way of doing it. But the search module is about searching. What do you use? I don't know, Elasticsearch, Lucene, something like that. You know, SQL Server, full text search. Not really, unless, of course, there's a constraint that you have to use SQL Server, which is perfectly fine. That can happen. Again, there's no single solution. Understand the context that applies to it. Okay. And then, I don't know, indexing-based architecture, I call that. Yeah. You may have a bus, not the one you drive, but some message bus or something to connect it to. Subscription, you know, you publish coarse grained events. Same thing here, a search module connects with the webhooks, you know, and does coarse-grained HTTP requests. That's perfectly possible. But by the way, and this also works if you have a distributed system. Same thing. The right tool for the right job. So if you take into account a more domain-focused module, so like the one which is about policy execution, lots of different people, event sourcing is a nice solution to that. Again, it's a style. It has pros and cons, and just for the people who don't know it. This is an example of an event-sourced architecture. This is like the autonomy of a module. It looks a bit like an onion. It's also called clean architecture. Robert C. Martin wrote that down. You know, the middle of the domain is based on domain-driven design, so you'll find value objects and aggregates and entities. This case is based on event sourcing. I'll show you in a second what it looks like. Every layer only has dependencies inward, so it really is really great for testing. All the infrastructure concerns, the webhooks, the HTTP APIs, the UI, is kind of on the outer side of the system. Integration, master data management, all this stuff is on the outside of the ring. Again, you don't have to do it like that. It's just an example. So don't go home and tell everybody, oh, now we need to build everything with onion architectures, because this dude at the conference told this is the great thing, the next big thing. Everything I say you should take with a grain of salt, and don't forget the hype cycle. That's the only thing, if you forget about everything else, it's Saturday, you know. Remember the hype cycle. That's a good one. Other things, yeah. Oh, yeah, I already mentioned that. Outer layers depend on inner layers. Yeah. Yeah, use interface sounds a bit weird, but I can imagine that every module also has a little bit of UI. You know, you build these composite UIs these days. If you look at, for instance, Amazon, it's like 100 different services, and they each have their piece of the UI, and we just display it as one thing. But if you really pay attention, you can actually see it just loads bits and pieces from different things, which is great because different teams own the modules, and every module has a specific UI for the functionality. For search, you have a, I don't know, faceted keyword search page. Whereas for drafting, maybe it's just a text field. You don't need anything else. So different modules, different UIs. Master data is there, yeah, okay. So what does event sourcing look like? I have a nice example here. I have an application. A command service sends a command. And if you do event sourcing, you typically also think about domains in a more functional way. That's where domain-driven design comes from. So you may have something like, I'm correcting my email address or my customer's email address. So you send a command. And it's written in the language of the business, also called ubiquitous language. This will find what we call a domain service or command handler, different terms for the same thing, which says, like, I want to have something that understands how to change the email of a customer. Okay? Then we have a unit of work, design pattern. You can look it up. And I'm asking the customer. I mean, design patterns also, eh? Cool. Just be careful when you apply that. Understand when they work, when they don't work, etc. Keep repeating myself. Instead of actually going to a traditional database structure, we go to something which we call an event store, which is usually just some kind of library that you use. But what it really does, it goes into a database and loads the entire history of that customer from the database. It's not loading like a record with the current state. No, it's loading the entire history. Customer was created, or customer was enlisted in a company. Customer credibility level was increased. The customer has moved to a different new location. The contact person for that customer has changed. The customer went bankrupt, something like that. So you actually load that. Then in .NET, at some point you will create a customer object and then tell the object to reinitialize itself based on that history. After that, it's just like as if I loaded my customer object using anti-framework from my relational database. Or you loaded it from RavenDB. Doesn't really change after that. But the essence is that the source of the domain are the events, hence the name event sourcing. It's not like everything that uses events is event sourcing, it's a specific pattern, which is well described. At that point, the command handler can say, now I'm going to say correct my email address. So the customer object has a method, correct email, will obviously check if the email's changed. If it has changed, it will apply the change. It will actually apply an event on itself, which will change the state at that point. After that, the command service will tell the unit of work, hey, I'm ready, because there could be a whole batch of commands, which is a beautiful thing. And just ask the unit of work, submit whatever happened in the domain back to the event store. So what does it do? The event store asks the user, the customer object, what has changed? And it will say, yeah, my email address has changed, event. And that is then stored in the event store. Which is an interesting pattern because it means that the event store is simply a very big table, completely flat. And that works. It's really cool because you can also do cool things like event merging. You can solve functional conflicts, not just by applying optimistic locking, but you can actually solve it in a more functional way. You can involve your product owner in decisions, which you as a developer love to do, because they never change their mind. Yeah, see? It's really, it's almost a pattern. Everybody recognizes that. Product owners change their mind. But then on the left side, you still need something to query this information or display this information. We call that projections. So in this case, I have a projector that responds on the fact that the email address has changed. It's an event. Usually these events are the same name as the command, but then written in past tense. We store that in a read database in whatever format that makes sense. So if you have in your module an HTTP API to give a list of all the legal documents that are being assigned to a particular lawyer, you just build a specific projection for that. That's what we call it, a specific table. It doesn't have to be a relational database, by the way. It can just be MongoDB. So you can decide that your event store is SQL Server because this is where the data needs to be. It needs to be safe and, you know, backupable. But the read side can be anything. You can treat it as a cache. You just rebuild it whenever you want to display it. Okay, there's a couple of libraries that you can use in a .NET space, since it's a .NET conference with 25 people developing. There's a couple of them. My preferred tool is MediaTR, which is from Jimmy Bogart. Again, you don't have to use any of this, just consider this stuff. Domain, there's lots of little libraries. There's no real big one that you can, I just put a couple of them. I also have no preference. I would probably roll my own code for that. I mean, every library I depend on is a dependency. Anybody has dependencies on Nutansoft? Jason? Everybody that codes has that dependency, I know. And they don't change their contract anytime. I mean, we have version 12 now in 2 years, 3 years. It's ridiculous. On the events, though, there's a lot of different libraries, actually. I don't really have a preference. I've used any event store in the past in products, but that's kind of stopped developing. Martin is from Jeremy D. Miller. Maybe you've heard of his name. He's a pretty famous guy. Has something. SQL Stream Store is just for relational databases, which is popular, created by Damien Hickey. It's a nice full tool. And on the projection side, there's not a lot. Project and the library that I built myself as a result of doing some development work there. It's called Liquid Projections. It's all going to be on the internet after this, guys. Okay. Is it time already? Oh, no. Functional modules, yeah. So we have to say, how does it work? Yeah, that's a good thing. So how does this what I just showed you work together? I have an HTTP API and I have an event store. Again, example. I have a projector that projects those events into something that HTTPIs can expose. Well, the difference is you don't actually want to expose those events that happen in the domain outside the module, because that's what a lot of people do, and it's kind of an anti-pattern, because what I'm saying is event sourcing or using Lucene or using CRUD is an implementation detail. It's an architecture style. So as soon as you start exposing those little details to the other modules, you create coupling. You will not be able to decide at a later point in time, I'm going to change the architecture style because my non-functional requirements have changed over the time. So don't expose that. So what we do, we take those fine events, what I just talked about, the events that represent things that happened inside that module, into more coarse-grained events. That's what we do. Actually, what it says, literally, fine. We create some kind of other event store that contains the payload. They have to track. There's a way to be able to say, okay, what are the messages that have happened in the right order so that other subscribers can actually see what happened in time? What's the last message that I received, that we use checkpoints for that? Now, there's also a projector and a monolith because it needs to handle these events, and it sends a subscription request to the HTTP API. Again, can be also .NET code. You don't have to do this. I mentioned before. And then we have projectors that receive a subscription. A projector just says like, hey, there's another module that I have to invoke telling that something happened in my domain. This projector uses the information from this payload events. These are coarse-grained events. So it could still be that the email address has changed, but it's an explicit event you expose to the rest of the system. If you feel like, ooh, this is really complicated, it's not that complicated. Just don't have to remember everything. But the projector then subscribes to those events internally and translates these into HTTP calls to the other modules. That's the way how the modules communicate to each other. And you still do this in process right now. Yeah, it projects the payload events into HTTP calls. And then the payload is being passed into some kind of callback API, which will use also something that handles those events and stores them into a format that it can use internally. You know, some projected data, can be anything, can be a table inside, it can even be in memory. You just, at startup, ask the functional module, give me all the legal documents or all the changes since I've started, create an in-memory list so that you can use it inside your existing monolith. It's really decoupled. You may feel like that's a lot of abstractions and indirections, but it's an option and it works. I've done it. Schema migration is one point you have to deal with that. There's different ways of dealing with that. Again, there's a couple of prerequisites. Every module needs to own its schema. There should not be any shared code that defines how the schema of the database looks like, because if you do that, then you lost the capability of having modules being autonomous, which is what you want. You need to support upgrading and downgrading. This is something. If you ever read the book about continuous deployment and continuous integration from, what is his name, Jeff, forgot the name. But it's a couple of years ago, like 10 years ago, there was a book about this CI/CD thing. And they also talk about if you really want to be efficient and you want to have a continuous deployment pipeline, you want to be able to upgrade your database schema, but also being able to roll back. Yes, if you can fix the bug in a really like couple of hours, you just roll out a new version. But if it's a business critical system, you want to be able to roll back the schema and have the old code base work with the data again. That is really important. There's tools for that, by the way. That's why NoSQL is great, because you don't have real schema changes. Although you still need to handle the fact that your NoSQL database may contain a document in a newer format than the old version of your code base can handle. So you also need to be able to convert back or be really smart about this stuff. But you can do an in-place upgrade. How does it work? I have an application, version 1 of the structure. I have the event store in there. The projector uses that. Then when the application starts, again, it owns the schema. It will basically say version 1 is no longer available, but it does this on the fly and creates a new version 2 on the fly. It doesn't mean you have downtime, because the application is not available until this new structure is available. Or maybe just the module is not available. Again, since the module decides it's using some kind of architecture style, it might be perfectly fine that if you deploy a new version of your monolith, and there's a new version of the module there, that the module is not available. For instance, if search is not available for a while, maybe that's not a problem at all. But you can also be really smart, saying, my code base supports both schemas. And until the new schema is updated, I keep using the old one, and after that, I lighten up new functionality. That's really possible. But you can also do blue-green, and that's really cool. I have version 1 of my application, which is completely independent. I spin up a version 2 of the application. What happens is the load balancer in front of it. The load balancer is aware of both deployments, both versions. However, version 2 will just say 5 or 3. I'm not available right now. And the load balancer will just say, okay, I'm going to redirect all the requests to version 1. Then in the meantime, all the events are copied over from the original event store to the new one, because an event store is an immutable structure, just add stuff to that. If you have something like that, it's really easy to copy over. You can even track how far you got. So in the meantime, version 2 does whatever it needs to do. We call that rebuilding or replaying all the events and build up a projection structure. When that's done, it tells the old system to bring itself offline, which will make it return 5 or 3. And after that, the new environment will say, hey, I'm ready. And suddenly new functionality is available. End users do not even know that this is happening. It's completely automatic and transparent, which is cool. Again, you have to build all this complexity, but it's a possibility. What about Node.net? Well, I'll skip this a little bit. Liquid projection, you can look at it offline. It's not really that cool. It's just a library that I've built, because I've spent the last 8 years on building event sourcing related systems. I've talked a lot about it. And I decided at some point to extract some of these patterns. I hate frameworks, by the way. So these are libraries. These are building blocks that you don't really need. No, that's not really useful. But they're building blocks that enable certain functionality, but you can take bits and pieces. That's the way I approach things. I decompose complicated problems into small pieces. Yes, you need to understand everything, but I hate these frameworks, and you just inherit from some kind of super base class, and suddenly all kinds of magic happens. That's really nice to get started. But as soon as you know, your code base is in production for a while, you start to run into the edge cases of a framework, And then you need to figure out, how does this framework work? Now I need something that the framework does not support out of the box. How do I hook into that? So I prefer to actually understand what this magic is doing, to make it really visible. And what does it look like? You have examples like a projection. This is what it looks like. It's mostly like a map, a bit of a fluent map where you say, this event needs to be handled in a certain way. You don't have to remember, you can look it up. But building .event-sourced application in .NET has become a lot easier. There's so much information, so much knowledge right now. It also started in the .NET world. The Java world is kind of catching up. So something to consider. Again, you don't have to. Tracking progress. You can, inside your projector, you can tell, you can report the telemetry about what is how it's going, and then you can have an endpoint that exposes information that the UI can use to say, hey, this projection structure, this data, or this projection is so far behind, I need to tell the end user that the search page is not completely up to date. Again, these are really advanced patterns, and you should not blindly apply them. Just, you know, use the information I tell you and look further. Well, so you've managed to start decomposing your monolith into modules. You've started to become accustomed to all the patterns that I'm talking about. Another question is, what's next? Is this it? No, it's not. There's ways to move further. So what do? Well, same thing here. You may have some routing conventions. You want to standardize on that. Inside the code base still, but you standardize. And standardizing things across different teams, at least for me, is always painful because they all have opinions. And if they're not the same as mine, yeah, that doesn't really work well. But it's also part of the thing, yeah? Working together, building a culture where you agree on certain things. Maybe you have, I don't know how this works in Romania, but maybe you have an architect and the architect just says, you shall do this, and everybody does it. Does it work like that here? Of course, we have 50% architects, so they don't know any better. They think, yeah. You can do other things. You start thinking about versioning of APIs. That's on itself already a heated debate. Do I use accept headers? Do I use some kind of URL convention? V1, response headers? There's tons of articles about that. Find some way that works for you. But yeah, your modules will evolve, and you don't want to do is breaking changes. So you need to think about V1, V2, and how they work together. Can I actually request from a service or from an HTTP endpoint, what are the supported APIs that you have? You may want to optimize the body, not just use JSON and HTTP, but like start using Protobuf or Afro. Although Afro, I haven't heard anything. I think it's already an old technology these days. Tracing, open tracing. Again, Alex Tisser will talk about this as well. But you can decide to say, I'm taking this module, this functional module, and put it into a separate service. So you started with everything in process, but now at some point, like I have one specific thing for which the conclusion is I need to scale it independently. So I take that module, which already has an HTTP API, has already adopted API versioning, already talks about using exposing webhooks to have like callback messages. It's already kind of prepared, and I put it in a separate host. That sounds interesting. So you've all done all the work. You already adopted a lot of principles that typically apply to distributed computing, but you've avoided the distributed computing problem. Now you're going to take your first step, put it in a service host. Maybe, because this is a much more efficient protocol, you switch to gRPC, and ASP.NET Core now has gRPC support. I'm not sure if it's completely production ready yet, but it's definitely here. And gRPC is what all the other cool people use. GitHub, Facebook, Amazon. You know, everybody outside .NET. That's the first step. You may still decide to not treat it as a web service. You can actually say, I'm going to have the monolith spin up the service host for me as a child process. So you don't need to think about Kubernetes and containers and that kind of stuff. You just say, when the monolith starts, it will also start that service host as a child process. There's a nice library in .NET called Little Forker that does it for you. And then you use a proxy, an HTTP proxy, to redirect all the internal requests to the external service. And there's a library, again, for that, ProxyKit, that can do that for you. It's in process. It's a very nice little library. So you're kind of, you know, taking steps to a real distributed thing without losing control. You know, Monolith starts, it starts a little background process for you. It tracks it. If it dies, it will restart it for you. But the monolith is the one that you deploy. So even your infrastructure teams, IT people, if you didn't adopt DevOps yet, don't need to know this. They just install the monolith as they always do. But for some reason, there's all these background processes. Building up the knowledge, because you'll suddenly find out that the network is getting more crappy, that you need to think about, even though it's all maybe local, the same machine, that the processes will die and you have to handle timeouts and you have to handle all these other things that you, but you're basically learning step by step. I mean, it's not like you turn 18 and immediately step in a spaceship and go to the moon. Eh? You first start to ride a bicycle. Actually, that little thing like that children do, the other one. Eh? Then a bicycle, then a moped, then a motorcycle, a car. You know, and eventually it's little steps that you take. You don't graduate from IT university and suddenly build a spaceship or a super complicated enterprise system. You start with small things. Same thing here. It's a path. But what is the path? Where does it end? And that's really cool. There is actually a path to microservices. How does it look like? There's a recipe I use. You first learn ways to put stuff into the cloud. That's a good start point. If you can do that. Some clients or some environments, you need to put everything on premise, but generally you go to the cloud. If you want to use containers, awesome. Learn about that as well. They also don't come for free. Anybody using Docker already? All these networking things and complicated scripts that you have to set up, it's not something you just do on the first day. You build up this skill set. And usually somebody starts with that. That's the early adopter. Then the whole organization needs to learn from that. But this isn't a skill that you need to build up before you're ready to pick up on the other things. You know, then you start maybe take the monolith and deploy it to the cloud in automated fashion. You know, you really do continuous deployment for the entire monolith based on what we had before, which is another learning experience. And then you completely automate your delivery pipeline. Literally, a pull request on the master branch in GitHub after it's approved, you know, it's reviewed, unit tests are successful, if you have unit tests. Sorry, I have to say it. I don't get that. Anybody using TDD then? Test-driven development? Oh my God. No, I'm not judging. I can tell you, you need to do all of that, if at least that's my experience. You need to do all of that if you really want to have an automated delivery pipeline. Unless you really love to put every code change just in production and hope for the best. It's a way, you can do that. But yeah, so step three is automate the entire delivery pipeline. You know, then you start to think about end-to-end responsibility. Maybe the team that owns the monolith and the modules actually also responsible for, you know, being woken up in the weekend if there's a production issue. That will make you adopt unit testing. I'm pretty sure you will, yeah? If you're then really ready to really go into the Microsoft world, really check out on the internet what's the current status quo. Come to a conference like that. You know, see what are the tools available. What are the pros and cons of those tools? Do I need an API gateway? Do I need Kubernetes? Am I going to run it on Azure, on Google Cloud, or on AWS? These are things you just need to start thinking about because they introduce a lot of new complications. Operational maintenance, people owning accounts, and all that stuff. You need to think about that. And then you start, you know, the path that you started, like take those modules, put them into containers, put them in the cloud, and you're really going to break up the delivery teams. This is kind of the path. Yeah, that's actually the whole story. It's a path. There's lots of complexity, but yeah, I mean, distributed computing is complicated, so why not just take it step by step? And that's the thing I'm saying. Again, take it with a grain of salt. It's just a path. I showed you a lot of different patterns today that you can use. And now they replace my screen with questions, and I should read them myself. Am I supposed to read them? Yeah. When is a good idea to not decompose your monolith? That's two questions. Would you please refactor this question for me? Would you consider microservices for a startup? So, I would say if you are very successful in your monolith and you don't really have the problems yet that I described, I would say postpone it as much as possible. As I said, as I explained, there's a whole path from monolith to microservices, which is not just technology. It's culture, it's people, it's tools, it's experience, it's time. Don't start from the start. Really building microservices, I don't know. I find that really, I could give the generic answer, it depends, but I would be really careful with that. Because there's so much things you need to think about. And it's not just, you know, go to GitHub, clone some kind of package that will, like a developer kit, that will make everything smooth. No, it's a distributed computing problem. That's complexity that you need to understand. So my question is, to the first one, it depends. And the, actually, yeah, it depends. Yes, any more questions? Okay. That was one question. In that case, I give you back 5 minutes. Oh, sorry, yes.
I have a question.
Yes.
My internet connection.
Your internet connection. Ah, so you have a distributed computing. It's not working. What? They just told me network is transparent. Now, go ahead, ask the question. So the question is, if you have a monolith, what would be the first part of the monolith that you try to decompose? That's a good question. The things that change the most. If you have parts in your monolith that don't change that much because it's pretty stable, don't bother. But it's the part that actually that people work on every day. If that creates all kinds of code churn and conflicts and merge conflicts, but if the, for instance, if you don't have any scalability issue, I wouldn't even bother this whole distributed thing. But creating internal seams, I mean, at some point, it never starts from scratch. That's why a lot of people say, always start with a monolith. At some point, you will discover that, oh man, it becomes so difficult to touch this part of the code base without understanding the rest. You know, complexity, your brain, at least my brain, can only fit a little bit of complexity at a time. So what do you do if something becomes too complex? You try to break it down to smaller chunks and really control the seams, to control the borders. But this is really hard to do that. That's probably forget about microservices. Just breaking down that complicated existing thing into smaller pieces is really difficult. And if you, for instance, don't invest in TDD and that kind of stuff, or unit testing, I can also recommend a very old book from Michael Fedders, which is like handling complexity or dealing with the legacy code, which helps you a bit in this respect. But generally, things that don't change, don't touch it. Just leave them there. If there's a scalability issue, or if there's a team collaboration issue, look at that part. First, try to find the seams. Try to make sure the seams are more clear. So try to introduce abstractions to really decouple things so that you at some point can extract it into a separate module. But that takes discipline and care. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Any more questions? Yes. That's a very long question. Let's after the chat talk a bit more detail because I need to understand first your problem before I can answer it.
How about
exception handling in this model.
With middleware or how I can make this in microservice?
Exception handling in microservices. So how do you? If you use HTTP, you would probably hide your exceptions and expose them as, for instance, HTTP error codes. There's a whole bunch of error codes. I would also adopt that. It's also related to how to log things, so logging is a concern. So hopefully Alex will also address that a little bit, how to trace exceptions across all these different modules or in the future across all these different exceptions. Exception handling in general is not an easy topic that I can give you a specific answer to. If you adopt HTTP, then you should adopt HTTP error codes and log your exceptions in a way that allow you to diagnose that. But yeah, it's a generic question, and I kind of only give you a generic answer. So maybe we can talk about it in more detail after the session. Yeah. Any other questions for now?
So,
there is
another question. We have internet from hotspot.
You have internet?
Yeah, from hotspot.
So can we go to YouTube or TikTok?
No, please do not do that.
You have briefly shown modules can communicate via bus as well as HTTP. Since message brokers can also do RPC, could the bus also replace HTTP? Yes, it can. Because as I said in the beginning, adopting HTTP is a very nice way of already preparing yourself for this distributed nature. But you can use a bus, you can even use an in-memory bus and later replace it with a more external bus, like Azure or AWS provide them. Oh, the text just changed, okay. That's perfectly fine, but the problem with RPC is that one service, if it needs information from another service or another module, it will have to do a call. And if that call just triggers another call, you have a whole chain of calls and they can all go wrong. It might be a good solution for certain things, but for different solutions, you actually want to have a more reactive approach. That's what I showed you in the example. One module just subscribes to things that happened in the other module and updates local cache, which will make sure that if one module is not available, which is not possible in the monolith, but if you start moving this in a separate process, it allows your monolith still to be working with the cache data. But this is all about asynchronous communication versus synchronous communication. This is again a trade-off, and you need to take case by case, look at what's the best option. So yes, a bus can replace some of these concerns. But usually with a bus, it's also vendor lock-in. You depend on that. Yes, you can create abstractions to hide that, but in general, yeah. I hope that answers the question for the anonymous person. Okay, we're running out of time. I thank you very much for being here in the morning. If you have more questions, approach me. I'll be here all day long, probably drinking my brand. And ping me on Twitter. Awesome that you've been here. I hope it makes sense. If not, good weekend.